I'm going to talk about transurethral ultrasound ablation outcomes. This is known as TULSA. I'll start by describing TULSA, which got CE approval in 2016, FDA approval in 2019 for tissue ablation. I'll talk about whole gland outcomes. We now have five-year outcomes from the TACT study, which was their pivotal approval study, some focal outcomes, some salvage outcomes, and the ongoing randomized trials, including CAPTAIN. Talk a little about future directions. So this is also an MRI-guided in-bore ultrasound ablation, just like Dr. Adai talked about. In this one, you insert a transurethral applicator, just like a rigid cystoscope, and a separate rectal cooling device. Intraprocedural MRI using T2 and now diffusion-weighted imaging guides the final robotic positioning of the applicator and your subsequent contouring, which now can be assisted with AI. You get up to 10 parallel ultrasound beams. Can be selected depending on the size of the prostate. These create a blade and a sweeping arc of thermal ultrasound high-intensity ablation. This will be continuous rotational sweep, and there's a rectal cooling device as well. This is an outpatient procedure performed, again, in bore MRI, under general, because you really don't want the patient to move. Once the applicator, which is the cystoscopic item, is positioned, the robotic device rotates and heat's delivered, and this is automatically modulated every 5 seconds with real-time MRI thermometry feedback. So you get all these slices, and then you get your contours filled with basically a wave of thermal ultrasound, and you can go clockwise, counterclockwise, you can go back and forth, you can go back to different areas, and you're getting real-time input on a really attractive MR interface. Again, similar to what we just heard, except coming from the urethra rather than the rectum. I'll start with the whole gland study because we have five-year data now, freshly, and it's really the best level of evidence we have. This was multi-center, 115 men, 13 sites in 5 countries, and this was low to intermediate risk cancer. Most had bilateral disease greater than greater than equal to 5 positive cores. Again, most intermediate risk. This was whole gland ablation in this trial with the urethral cooling and the rectal cooling. There were endpoints such as PSA reduction adverse events, but obviously we're all interested in some of the secondary endpoints like biopsy at 1 year and how we're doing at 2 to 5 years. And this was published in JU in 21 by Dr. Klotz, and as a disclosure, I was on that trial. At 1 year, I think the most interesting thing was we basically forced everyone to get a biopsy. 111 out of 115 agreed. The negative biopsy rate, now again, the prostate was shrunk from 30, 40, 50 grams down to basically 3 to 10. These were specks of prostates that were remaining. So it was kind of, a saturation biopsy. Obviously, if the MRI showed something, you'd target that as well. But everyone got at least 10 cores in a volume of, 3, 4 cc's. 65% negative. Of the 35% that were positive, about half of those were clinically insignificant disease. In other words, 1 or 2 cores, less than 50% GG1 Epstein criteria. And you can see sort of the bars there, the dark blue and the less dark blue would be considered significant disease, and that sort of goes away at the 1 year biopsy, except in about 20% of the cohort still has what we consider significant disease, although many of them still went on to be surveilled over time. This, in fact, was the pivotal study, and these are some of the results. You can see on the left the PSA curves. Even out at 5 years, 60 months, you've got PSAs of less than 1, averaging about 0.63. You can see on the upper right curves, you can see on the upper right continence and then potency in the lower one. This is all by Epic questionnaire, and these are quite good outcomes considering this is whole gland ablation and would have to be put into context with radical prostatectomy or radiation therapy if you wanted to go head to head. Bottom left, histological outcomes. You've got, again, at baseline, 63% had grade group 2. Like I said, fairly high volume, even in the GG1 cases. The 1 year biopsy, no clinically significant disease in 80% of men. And then the 5 year salvage treatment free survival rates are at 79%. So meaning 21% underwent additional intervention by 5 years, 10 prostatectomies, 10 radiation therapies, and some combined radiation and androgen deprivation, et cetera. Repeat TULSA at this point was not permitted, but that is something obviously that's possible to do. Or cryo or other focal therapies if ablative therapies if required. I'm told these went reasonably well from the surgeons who did the radical prostatectomies and the radiation therapists. The TACT study informed both physicians and the company about what considered what were the modes of treatment failure, and they've worked hard to sort of improve that for the next iteration of the technology, sometimes software, sometimes hardware upgrades. Basically, they saw there was some unintentional prostate tissue sparing, insufficient margins, and, you know, over the years, they've started, you know, teaching urologists how to apply the applicator better, position it better, robotically adjust it. We now use not just ADC, but diffusion-weighted imaging for the contouring. We can now apply a thermal boost to areas that are not getting treated to get to higher temperatures, like close to 70 C. Number two, acoustic shattering due to calcifications. That was a big issue. And it was found that basically calcifications 3 centimeters plus are going to be a real problem. But even the smaller ones now, you can actually do susceptibility-weighted imaging, which means putting the ablation blades sort of so that they go around the calcification and don't actually hit it. So that's a new modification with the software. And there's occasionally just misalignment by prostate swelling during the treatment, and that can be changed. Now they have a on-the-fly target boundary adjustment during the ablation. You can stop, change the border, and sweep again. So I think there's improvements. You know, these were basically first-of-its-kind data. This is just a picture of, that's the concept of moving the beams around the calcification there in the left slide B, just showing that I think the technology is improving and treatment times are getting shorter, and we're able to boost and get around calcifications a little better. Real-world patient selection in the US aligns with these published outcomes. In other words, right now, looking back at what people have been doing, about 80% of treatments in the US are subtotal, essentially whole gland ablations, you know, very, you know, regional, like three quarters of gland, et cetera, or more. The 10 directional beams plus the MRI precision can enable these large ablation volumes while still preserving quality of life. And as we just heard from Dr. Dai, large ablations do have advantages. You know, obviously, fewer out of field and margin recurrences. It allows for focal therapy in patients with more diffuse lesions. It allows you to get that nice 1 centimeter margin we talk about. And in fact, if you do enough, you can relieve LUTS, which has been seen in virtually all the patients with larger glands in any TULSA treatment. But I think the design itself is really promising for a more focal or customizable, you know, sextant or quadrant ablation, just because of the nature of the sweep and the different elements you can engage. And so here's an example of a group in Germany that basically just took their 21st patients and published on it. Very little guidance, you know, just kind of went with it. And they did, you know, reasonably well. It looks like, to me, 4 gray group 1 and 16 gray group 2 patients were treated. They got a follow-up MRI at 6 months, and they recommend biopsies. 14 men agreed to the biopsy. Again, probably, again, a biased group that probably had rising PSA or a positive MR. But nevertheless, They only had recurrences in the focally treated patients, not the whole gland treated patients. These were recurrences in men who were all GG2, and the recurrences were GG2 or GG3 in 29% of patients. These were all out-of-field recurrences. 2 of the 4 also had in-field recurrence. If you look to the right, you'll see again the concept of this is not really small focal specs. 24% of these are whole gland, 30% are partial regional, and then 46% are partial with a lot of anterior zone to include sort of BPH treatment and some bilateral treatment. In a systematic review, and I'll move pretty quickly now, Dr. Dora from Mayo Jacksonville looked at sort of 224 patients across 10 studies and tried to compare salvage-free treatment rates on the left chart with planned ablation fraction. On the far right of that slide, it's the TACT trial patient. So the more tissue you ablate, obviously, the lower, the higher salvage-free rates you have. And on the right, of course, the more you ablate, the worse erectile function you get. And it seemed that a sweet spot mathematically was if you ablate, again, you know, 3/4 of the gland, 75 to 85 gland volume, you get an attractive risk benefit between successful cancer treatment and avoiding some of the side effects like ED. Again, kind of a modeling retrospective exercise. Very good salvage data coming out of Dr. Antinen in Finland. I won't go over it in depth, but this has been looked at. And he's up to 40 patients now. The first publication was 11. Then there was a presentation at EAU. But basically, a very thoughtful approach to this. This is biopsy-proven radio-recurrent cancer. He's got oncologic effects at 1 year in 26% of men. and really only two biochemical recurrences and a 12% positive rebiopsy rate. And some of these were at the base or in the seminal vesicles, really not very much in the treatment area, with a reasonable safety quality of life. If you look at that closely, you know, still a lot of grade two events, one osteitis pubis, et cetera. So this is obviously a little higher complication rate that you get in, you know, virgin prostates primary treatment, but good in terms of IPSS incontinence. And just to introduce, this is an ongoing trial now, sponsored by Profound, targeting 200 patients overall, 2-to-1 Tulsa whole gland or customizable whole gland, meaning you're allowed to spare a nerve bundle or spare certain aspects if there's really no cancer there, but essentially whole gland versus radical prostatectomy. Very well-designed study, ongoing and accruing, and looking for, you know, more centers, and those are the centers that are involved here. So that'll obviously take a long time to get final results. Ultimately, to summarize, you know, we saw TULSA is performed under anesthesia, inborn and MRI, through a rotating cystoscopic applicator with 10 beams of energy that you can really customize to whatever parts you want. Effectiveness can be hampered by extremely large gland sizes. So if you go out to more than 3 centimeters from the center, from the urethra, you may not be able to get beyond that. So that's an inclusion for CAPTAIN. And of course, coarse calcifications are a problem. You can't get around things more than 3 millimeters, so we get a CT, pelvic CT before TULSA. I think the focal data from small centers plus the tact whole gland data at 5 years suggest this is a safe technology in terms of complications and continence preservation. Oncologic efficacy is still under study, but is definitely comparable to major modalities and suggests that providers and patients need to be open to the need for salvage therapies in a minority of patients, and that can be repeat TULSA or RP or RT, with those are the recurrence rates. Level one evidence will be gained with the CAPTAIN trial, which is accruing, and I think honestly, as the indications for AS keep expanding, trials comparing AS for intermediate risk patients versus a focal customized version of TULSA would seem to be a high priority. And this is a list of some trials that are going on, mainly against RP. And again, I want to thank the organizers for this very timely set of topics and conference, and Profound, who's been very proactive to help run clinical trials. Thank you.